Welcome to This Week in Hastings Headline History, where we take a look back at what was making news around Hastings, Florida over a century ago. These are stories directly out of the pages of the Hastings Herald, which was published weekly in the early 1900s. It's fascinating to hear what they were talking about, as well as how they spoke in their articles from over 100 years ago. So sit back and enjoy as I share with you a few of the articles from This Week in 1920. 100% growth of Hastings reported. Returns from the 1920 census show that the incorporated town of Hastings has increased by almost 100% since 1910. Its present population being 761, as against 399 when the former census was taken. St. Augustine shows a gain of 698, which is roughly about 13%, and brings the population of that city up to 6,192. No money for teachers. The announcement that in all probability the school authorities will be unable to increase the pay of teachers for the coming year comes as a distinct shock to every person interested in the local schools. In the same statement in which it makes known its inability to increase salaries, the board announces itself as being seriously hampered by a shortage of teachers for the coming year. In consideration of the former statement, the latter is by no means surprising. In fact, the only surprising feature is that the board does not find itself forced to announce its inability to obtain any teachers at all. Speaking of teachers, there were some visiting teachers in Hastings this week in 1920. The article reads, "The teachers in question who are traveling under the pseudonym of Mildred and Marianne West have been spending the summer making a walking tour from Washington to Miami and return. And when they passed through Hastings yesterday, they looked husky enough to handle an entire room full of unruly schoolboys without even losing their breath. The teachers are making what they term a tour by automobile. That is, they walk when nobody invites them to ride. They left Washington on July 1st and expect to return about September 1st. They are both carrying packs and blanket rolls and stated they could average 15 miles a day when obliged to walk. That they have walked a considerable portion of the distance is indicated by the fact that they have each worn out 3 pairs of shoes. They were dressed in rough clothes, which seemed a sort of combination between masculine and feminine apparel. That they were prepared for any untoward event was evidenced by an occasional glimpse of the hilt of a revolver peeping from a pocket. The revolver is not being the toy pearl-handled variety, but a real six-gun intended for actual business." Why Miss Jones Smiles. Miss Frances Jones of St. Augustine was a visitor at the record office Tuesday, and her smile conveyed more than the usual return from vacation joy that shines upon the faces of people who come back to St. Augustine after sojourn in other parts of the country. The brightness of that illumination was explained when it was found that Mrs. Jones Ford now rejoices in a self-starter, or rather that the Ford has a self-starter and Mrs. Jones does the rejoicing. This convenience has been supplied the visiting nurse through the kindness of Mr. and Mrs. J.C. Hart, residents of St. Augustine. There will be no more twisting of a cranky flivver tail for Miss Jones now that she has this modern touch to her Ford, for all that is necessary is a touch upon the button and away she goes. Now it's time for Talk of the Times, where we take a look back at what people were thinking over 100 years ago. This week we have an editorial from the paper. It's titled Brains versus Brawn. And it reads, "Some months ago, at a time when railroad brakemen and window cleaners were just entering the plutocrat class, a Harvard professor getting less than half the amount paid a railroad man made the observation that it is worth more to break the train than to train the mind. As brawn continues to outweigh brains, it is interesting to note the degree to which the comparison may be carried. Some time ago, the Tribune published an editorial under the caption of 2 advertisements. They presented the ridiculous comparison between the wages paid the schoolteacher and those paid to common day laborers. The comment of the Tribune is so pertinent that we produce it here with the hope that those who have to do with the arranging of pay of teachers do everything possible to give them fair compensation. From the New York World, says the Tribune, we take the following wanted column. Window cleaners on store windows. Wages, $7.50 per day. From the Manchester, New Hampshire Guardian, we produce this one. 100 young women to whom life is not altogether a matter of dollars and cents, to take positions in New Hampshire's rural schools at pay $15 per week. Let us come closer to home. At the Tampa car yard, you will find a woman washing car windows 8 hours a day at $30 a week. Also in Tampa, you will find educated women, teachers, working for about twice that per month teaching your children. Is it any wonder we cannot get our boys and girls to talk about a college education? Who wants to put in 4 to 6 years in college learning classical usages and the correct way to express our English when in the end, we will have to take a position at something like $100 to $150 a month in some school or college as a teacher or professor, when one can step out and join the union and with a sign and hammer in hand report on a job of carpentry at $1 an hour or a plasterer at $1.25 an hour or as a riveter at a wage that nets over $100 per week straight time. Brain has been made to take the back place in the financial side of the world. As soon as Brain builds up an enterprise that needs labor to carry it on, in comes labor and demands that it be turned over to it, or that it be a sharer with the brain and the results of accomplishment. It is a double-headed penny that is flipped today, and Brain has no chance, for it's always tails for Brain in the gamble where organized anarchy holds the coin. I hope you enjoyed this week's edition of Hastings Headline History. This podcast was brought to you by Presenting the Past, bringing history back to the present through historic presentations and the sale of treasures from days gone by. This episode was written and produced by me, Michelle Murillo, with the aid of vintage copies of the Hastings Herald. Now it's time for this week's musical memory when we listen back to a song that everyone was listening to over 100 years ago. This week's song is one considered very important in the development of jazz music. The tune was originally composed in 1906, and because of that early year, it is considered to be the first stomp in the history of jazz. Composer Jelly Roll Morton wrote it in that first decade of the 1900s and named it after a friend and fellow piano player, Porter King, but he didn't record it until 1923, and at that point, it was just him and his piano. While the song did well at that time, it went on later to become a massive hit in the swing era after Benny Goodman recorded it. But let's go back to that earlier version by the original composer. Here's Jelly Roll Morton and the King Porter Stomp.